Welcome to Peninsula Seniors Out and About. Today we're at the Western Museum of Flight in Torrance for one of their celebrity lectures. Let's go see what Cindy has for us today.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the Western Museum of Flight. I'm Cindy Maka, and I'm the director for the museum. The bombing raid on the Ploesti oil fields in Romania was one of the most strategically devastating strikes against the Nazi war machine during all of World War II. Unfortunately, it was also one of the most costly strikes, in which American forces lost a far higher percentage of participating aircraft than on any other raid. Clearly, the airmen who flew those missions exhibited a scale of personal courage that would place them in the highest orders of bravery in the entire history of military conflict. Considering the losses, those who returned from that raid also ranked among the luckiest. We are privileged today to have one of those incredibly brave and extraordinarily lucky pilots. His name is Robert Sternfels, and his aircraft, the Sandman, now has a place among the memorable images of World War II, because it is Sternfels B-24 Liberator that appears in a famous photo as it fights its way out of the inferno that was Ploesti. Ladies and gentlemen, Robert Sternfels.
The Ploesti raid was a very high priority raid. Going to Ploesti, Romania, was very, very important for the Americans and the English. And the reason it was that when we got into the war in 1941, we didn't have anything. And now when I say we didn't have anything, I mean it. We had 2,500 aircraft, and almost 90% of those were biplanes and trainers. We didn't have a modern airplane. Now, the Germans did. And as you know, they were in the war with Spain, or not, they didn't fight Spain, but they were in that war, and they furnished the aircraft for that war, and that was in 1935 and 1936. So they had a long time to sharpen the aircraft and also to develop systems, which we never had. And if you ever look at a Messerschmitt 109, you'll find that that is almost as perfect as one of our modern planes. It's nice to have everything at your fingertips. And a lot of those gauges and a lot of those switches and everything were perfect in that 109 airplane. They had a lot of time to organize what they were going to do. So when we got into the war, we had a P-40. And the P-40 was a real, and I hope you guys don't take this, whoever flew one, was a real dog as far as I was concerned. And it had an Allison engine in it, which couldn't go any higher than 15,000 feet if it ever got up there. And I flew one once, and I was so disappointed. I thought the thing would go at least, or indicate at least 300, and it indicated about 200, just barely 200 miles an hour. But anyway, when we got into the war, we didn't have much. So President Roosevelt was having a rough time fighting two wars without an adequate amount of military equipment. And not only that, but he also was being pressured by the English. And Churchill, who was a prime minister of England, came over here and stayed in the White House and obviously influenced Roosevelt on where to put the military equipment that he had. Well, he didn't have much. But down here in San Diego, they did have an airplane that was being built for the French, and it was called a B-24. And it played a very important part in the war, even in the early part and the late parts of the war. It was the only aircraft that was used in every single theater, and at the end of the war, they counted them up, and they had over 19,000 that were built. But that aircraft provided the Americans with a source of bombing Ploesti, Romania. And how did that happen? Well, how did it happen was an interesting story, and it's a very quick one. Now, we're talking in 1942. Now, when was Pearl Harbor? 1941 and the end of 41, and then we had Christmas, and so nothing really started until January of 1942. From January of 42 to May of 1942, they assembled about 50 B-24s, and they sent them over to, they were going to go over to China. Well, they couldn't go through Hawaii and the Philippines and so forth. So what they did was that they were going to send them the other way, and they were going to take them through Cairo, Egypt, and the back door, in other words. And it was called the Halverson Group. And they got as far as Cairo, Egypt, and they got word that they got to stay there, because the fields that they were going to use in China were taken over by the Japanese. Now, isn't that a coincidence that the Japanese just happened to take over the airfields that we were going to use? Well, anyway, that's what happened. So when this group was in Cairo, why, they were helping the British, because the Germans were knocking on the door, you know, of Cairo. So anyway, they were ordered to go to Ploesti. Well, they never even knew where Ploesti was, and neither did I when I went over there. But they were told that they were going to bomb Ploesti. Well, you weren't supposed to fly over a neutral country, and you had to fly over Turkey, or around Turkey. Well, the colonel that was in charge, Halverson, couldn't say to the people that, look, that we were ordered not to fly over Turkey, but there is another route that you can fly, and that is around Turkey, but you won't get back. So yeah, I'll leave it up to you. If you go straight, why, that's great. Anyway, they did. They flew over Turkey. They took off on June the 12th of 1942, one by one in the early morning, and they finally got to Ploesti. They didn't join up, but each individual got to Ploesti, and guess what happened? They had a ground cover. They couldn't see the ground, and we didn't have radar. So the navigator said, well, we should be there. So the guy pressed the button and dropped the bombs. Well, even if they could see the ground, they couldn't hit anything anyways. But anyway, they dropped the bombs, and nothing happened. And they went up to Iraq and Iran and got gas, and then some of them came back. Some of them landed in Turkey. And due to the fact that Turkey was neutral, they interned the aircraft. But the Turks didn't want the people, so they put them up in a hotel, and they didn't have any guards or anything, and the guys were just floating around the towns. And so a lot of them made their way back to their bases, which was in Cairo. But that's the first raid that was made on Ploesti, Romania. And that's how important it was. The very first raid in Europe was the Ploesti oil fields. Now, why was the oil field so important? Because Germany doesn't have oil, so they had to make the oil from, or make the gas or the oil from coal. Well, that system, called the Fischer something else, is a very, very viable system, but it's a very costly system. But Germany, that's the only way that they could feed the gasoline engines and also the diesel engines. They made their oil from coal. But the other thing was that they couldn't use that gasoline that they made, because the gasoline wasn't a high enough octane. It is today. They have different systems today, but then you couldn't use it. So he had to get a regular natural crude oil, and the only way he got that was from Ploesti, Romania. So that target was very, very important to Hitler, and they decided that that would be the number one target of all the raids that they were making at that time. And I didn't know where Romania was, even though I was in North Africa, until they started to tell us where we were going to go. About the middle of July of 1943. And at that time, they said, we're going to make a raid, and it's going to be a long one. And he said, instead of flying at 25,000 or 22,000 or 27,000 or 28,000, we're going to fly at low level. So one guy raised his hands and he said, how low? Now, don't forget, we were on the desert, and we were out in the open. We didn't have a facility like this to have a briefing. And there were camels and camel riders all around us and everything else. Everybody trusted everybody else, I guess. But anyway, they said, you can fly as low as you want to, but don't hit the camels because we don't know where to get them. See? But one guy did actually, apparently, got too close to a camel. But anyway, we practiced low-level flying on the desert. Now, you pilots that have flown on the next to the ground in hot days, you all know that the it's just rough as a cob. You bounce all over the place. Well, that's exactly what we did when we were practicing. Well, the day came, or before that, I'll go back just for a second. Before we were grounded, a man came up to my airplane in a staff car. And I saw this staff car in the distance. You know, the desert was flat as this floor here. I saw this car in the distance, and behind him was a cloud of dust, you know, that they bring up and everything. And so anyway, he kept coming right towards me, and they stopped in front of my airplane. And the driver got out and opened the door for this guy, and he got out, and he was a colonel. And he came up to me, and I was a lieutenant at that time, and he said, Lieutenant, I'd like to go on a mission with you. Well, you know, being 21 years old or 22 years old, I thought, you know, I'm going to ask the guy if he's got a ticket. But I didn't. But anyway, I said, yes, sir. And he said, I'm Colonel Jake Smart. And that didn't go anywhere. So I introduced him to the other crew members, and I said, are you intending to fly? And he says, no. He said, you are. And so anyway, I took him on his first mission. Apparently it was his first mission in the European theater. And when we were flying, we had our oxygen mask on. And, you know, we put them on about 10,000 feet. And, however, if you had a bad night, what you would do would be to put it on as soon as you got in the airplane. And then it was a lot better. So we had our oxygen mask on, and he stood between the pilot and the co-pilot. And that's where my engineer stood. And he was there taxi. So I asked him, I said, Colonel, would you mind if my engineer stood there because he watches everything for me? And he said no. So he was very polite and got away from there. And my engineer stood there. And then we took off. And along the route, why we were up about 15,000 or so, and all of a sudden I saw his hand go like this. Well, he was my guest on the airplane, and I'm the pilot. And I know what I'm doing, and he was moving my throttles, or the mixture controls. See? And it just caught me in my eye, and I thought, what the hell is he doing? So anyway, I put him back where I wanted him. So we got up a little higher, and his hand came up again and started to move the mixture controls. See? This time I got mad. I opened my oxygen thing, and I said, Colonel, please don't touch the controls. See? And that's why I only made a major. Anyway, He did that. He came down and he thanked me and he disappeared. And when we were having our briefings, why, he was always on the podium. So finally we found out that he was a planner for the Ploesti mission. See, well, 1993, fast forward, 1993, my wife and I took a trip in our motorhome around the country, and we arranged to see General Smart. Now he's a general. So anyway, I saw him at his house. He had retired. And I was thinking on the way there, how in the hell am I going to ask him why he was fooling with my controls? Because if you get going to the airline, you know, they won't even let you in the cockpit anymore. But this guy was up there fooling with the controls, and that's a no-no. So anyway, I asked him, I was thinking, how do I ask him? I know he's not going to remember. So I asked him what experience he had in a B-24. And he said, I just got checked out the week before. Well, when you get checked out in the airplane, you generally don't go up to high altitude, and therefore you don't know how to use the mixture controls. You always leave them in full rich, don't you? Because that's what you need. You need full rich. And he was fooling with those, thinking that it should be in full rich at all times. And you can't do that. You got to lean it out, because if you don't, you use too much gas and you won't get back. The air's thinner, so therefore you don't need as much gas. So anyway, that was the answer. He didn't know. And yet he planned the B-24s for low-level flying over Ploesti. Anybody have any questions?
I heard that the B-24, let's say it's compared to the B-17, was a hard airplane to fly from the standpoint of pilot fatigue and that sort of thing. Could you comment on that?
Yeah, the B-24 took a lot more muscle to fly it. And it reminded me of one of the Fords that I had one time going down the freeway. You just couldn't keep that thing going straight unless you steered it every minute. Well, the B-24 was like that. But an interesting thing, last Wednesday, a group of us went out to Edwards Air Force Base, and we had a beautiful tour by the man that was in charge of the flight line, or the flight testing line, which meant that when a modification is made on an airplane, they then take it to Edwards and they test it to see whether it's going to be beneficial or not, or whether the expense is adequate for the change. And while we were out there, while they were showing us a B-52, you know, which is about, well, how old are they? About 60 years old or 50 years old? And then they showed us a B-1 and a B-2. And very, very interesting program that we had. And it was done by the colonel, who's Colonel Miller, that was in charge out there. And he just happens to be a groupie for this Ploesti raid. So we got along pretty good. Anyway, the point of the story is that we were asking the pilots how certain airplanes flew. And I said, well, how about the B-52? How does that fly in comparison to the B-1? He said, well, the B-1 is like a Cadillac, and the B-52 is like a Ford. He said it takes a lot of muscle and everything. And you know the words that they use, fly-by-wire? Hell, we invented that one, because that's all we had, was that our controls were directly connected to the ailerons and to the rudders. And if you have a big airplane, it's like a big truck without power steering or power brakes. You just got to muscle it. And I had real big muscles at that time, plus the fact that I had calluses all over my hand like this at this point. And that was due to the fact that we had a control wheel that had two horns on it that stuck up, and you had to grab that and then grab the throttles as you were flying formation. And so you had to move this back and forth. Well, They used a real small, about this small, wheel. And it's hard to grab that real tight. So I took rope and I roped it. And of course that made it very rough on your hand. But it was a much harder airplane to fly straight and level than the B-17, because the B-17, the parts were taken from the Stratocruiser, which was developed back in 1935, 1936. And they used the wings of the Stratocruiser for the B-17. And all they did was make a new fuselage and do all the other things that were necessary. But you're right, it was a much harder plane to fly. It takes a real man to fly it, yes. Were they modified? Yeah, they took out the Norton bomb sights. They were worthless for that mission. And the bombs? Not as far as I know, they didn't modify them. The only thing is that you know how a bomb works. They have a propeller on it, and it spins, and they can program that. And what that does is release acid. And if you want it for a long time, why, they can program it so the propeller would have to go along a long time before it punctured the place where the acid was. And if you wanted to have the bomb go off instantly, why, then you'd program it another way. But these were programmed so that the bombs would go off after we left the area, the last person left the area. That all went down the tubes when Colonel Keith Compton, K.K. Compton, turned at the wrong place. And he destroyed that whole plan. And because the other airplanes hit the target that we were supposed to hit, and hit other targets too. And they were on fire when we got there. And we thought before we arrived there, we thought by looking down, we could see where the fire was. And we thought that maybe the Germans had these smoke pots out so that they were blowing the smoke over the target. But that ain't the way it was. It was that the other people had bombed our target, so some of the bombs were even going off. Frankly, I did not see the ground. And I was 150 or 200 feet above the ground. I didn't see it. And because it was all on fire. And I asked my bombardier, I said, when did you drop the bombs? Or how did you know when to drop it? He says, I couldn't see the ground. He says, all I did was drop it when there was fire underneath us. And he dropped them.
How many of the downed pilots actually survived, or crew? Crew? Air crew people, how many of them?
Well, it's hard to answer that question because the raid that I was on, they lost about 500 and some odd guys, and we don't know exactly how many survived in Romania. But a year later, they went over with thousands of airplanes from Italy, and it wasn't an easy target, and a lot of them were shot down. So there could be a lot of prisoners of war from that higher raid or the higher raids rather than from the raid that I was on.
Robert, what was the fate of your aircraft?
Yes, I'm glad you asked that question because I forgot about it. Well, actually, I didn't know anything about the aircraft, where it actually landed. When it went down, it was December the 19th, and I was in R&R, or at R&R, in Bari, Italy, and we were having a lot of fun, and another crew took the airplane. Sometimes that happens, even though I was squadron commander, and they knew that this would have, my airplane would be the last one that they would have to take, see. Anyway, a man that... Hobby is locating airplanes, was up in the hills or the Alps of Italy, and he was told about an airplane that did come down during World War II. He found the airplane found what was left of the airplane. And it turns out that when it hit, it splattered. And many of the parts were picked up by the villagers. And many of them were melted down because aluminum was, you know, scarce. And the propellers and all those things were all melted down, and maybe they were made into pots or something else. But there was one part that was used as a doorstop, and one of the villagers donated it to the guy that found the airplane. And so they took off all the dirt and everything else off of the bottom of the back of the of that part, and they found a serial number. And there's a man in the United States called Al Blue who has a room full of documents about every airplane that was built for the service. And they looked it up, and they found that that particular production number was from my airplane, and that's how they identified it. Well, later on, and I don't know why that the Air Force doesn't have this in their archives, but later on the Air Force went over to England, went over to all these different places, you know, to pick up the remains of people. And in the churchyard or church cemetery in this little village, they were told that all these remains were from the crew of that airplane, and they identified them, and they were sent back to St. Louis, and they're all buried in a cemetery in St. Louis. And the man that flew that plane, you may not have caught it, but there was a picture of a pilot that was flying the airplane, and that was the man that flew my plane and when it was shot down. And they do have a record of the German pilot who shot down the plane. And there is a video on this that was shown in Italy about 2 years ago. So, but all that remains of it, and oh, by the way, the guy that found it also sent me three parts of the plane. They sent me part of the tire, and they sent me part of the flap, and they sent me also part of the turbocharger. And those are going to be on display at Lyons Museum down here at John Wayne Airport. When I got those three parts, a chill went through me to think that that was my plane. And I picked it up in Topeka, Kansas in 1943. And when I was 22 years old and had these nine guys with me. And the first time that the sergeant, you know, he was bored with what he was doing, and he says, "Yeah, you can get the plane. Take this one." He said, "It's on the flight line. Go out there and see if it's okay." So we took our crew and we went out to see the plane, and so I said, "Well, first thing we got to do is see if it flies." So we all got in it and we started it up, and I checked the mags, and boy, one mag just wasn't working just right. But anyway, we tried to clear it out. We thought maybe it was, you know, oil that had accumulated on the spark plugs. We finally got it running right, and we took it off, and sure enough, the tachometer started to do fancy things, and so I feathered it and came around and landed. And then I pulled it up to the place again, and we tried it again, and it looked fine. I mean, it checked out fine on the ground. I took off again, and sure enough, same thing happened. Well, this time I called the crew chief, and I said, "Come on out here and tell me what's wrong with this thing." So he came out, and you know, being a second lieutenant, it is tough because you're right at the very bottom of everything. And a master sergeant, you know, knows more than you do. So anyway, he came out, and he says, he checked it out. He said, "There's nothing wrong with this thing." And I said, "Sergeant," I said, "you're going to go with me on a trip right now." And he says, "Okay." So he went on the trip. We got down, and he says, "It'll take 2 days to replace the engine." So, but anyway, that baby I took all the way from Topeka, Kansas, through South America, and over to Cairo, Egypt, and then to Libya. And it took a month to get there. So, any other questions? The question was, how did we name the airplane? Well, I had nothing to do with it. I said, crew, what do you want to call it? And they said, well, we'll call it the Sandman. And we were on the desert with all the sand and everything. But I thought that it had some connection with the song, Sandman, you know. But the song came in later. That had nothing to do with it. See? So anyway, the only thing that I contributed to it is that I drew the name Sandman. And somebody painted it on the airplane. But those little ducks that are on the bottom, they were going to represent each mission. But they got to the point where the ground crew said, oh, hell, we're running out of space. Forget it. But that airplane made 48 missions before it was shot down. It was a good airplane. And we used, the sand on the desert was very, very fine. I mean, it wasn't like you see out here in the shoreline. But it's very, very fine. It's like face powder, even finer than face powder. And that would get into everything. And instead of getting, say, 1,000 hours on our engines, if we got 500 or 250, we were doing good. You know, the reason for that is that you could always tell how much gas you were using, but you couldn't tell how much oil you were using. And as a result, if you don't catch it right at the right moment and that tachometer needle starts to go like this and you don't feather it right away, you can't feather that prop at that time. Now they've changed that system and the pressure keeps the prop in the location, and then when you lose it, it automatically goes to feather. But it didn't at that time. And so we had a rough time. Incidentally, does anybody ever hear of how they repaired those engines over in the desert? Well, what they did was the English did everything. They supplied us with toilet paper and food and everything else. And we all paid, the United States paid for it. But they repaired the engines. And underneath the pyramids, they had tunnels. And so they took one of those tunnels to be used as a repair station. And I know this for a fact because I asked General at the time now, General Jake Smart, when I saw him, I said, where did they repair the engines? And then he told me the story. He said, they did it in the tunnel under the pyramids. And I said, well, where'd they get the mechanics? He said, they took them off the streets of Cairo and they taught them how to use a wrench. And honestly, they did a pretty good job, but every once in a while, they'd put the engine on and the damn thing wouldn't run. But anyway, they did a pretty good job. I didn't tell you, but you guys, how many pilots are here? Okay, well, you know what an IP is. That's where you go and then turn to another heading and you go to the target. We went to a place called Ploesti, Floesti, and it's about 12 miles north of Ploesti. And at that particular place, we were to make a right turn and go down the railroad track to this Astro Romano refinery that they showed you on the movie. And the reason for that is that that was the largest refinery that they had in Ploesti. And we had more airplanes in behind us, and we were supposed to hit that particular target. When we made that turn, and we were in trail, because with these heavy airplanes, you can't just turn like that. Like Joe here can do it with a P-38; he can stand it on the wing. See, you can't do that. So, and we were only about 200 feet, and our wingspan on one side was 55 feet. So that made us very close to the top of the trees. So anyway, we were going around very slowly, and we got into trail, and there was a railroad track right next to us. It wasn't any further away than that wall over there. And on that railroad track was a train, a steam train, And I know it was steam because the smoke coming out of the stack was black, and it was laying right down on top of the cab. And when that occurs, you know damn well he's going fast. And well, behind that train were about 15 flat cars, and on the flat cars were guns. And so when we went, we were parallel with them, or they were parallel with us, at the same time that we made our turn, and I felt like we were ducks in a shooting gallery, because they were shooting down. We lost 22 airplanes between the time we turned and the target. And we had 48 airplanes to start with. And I was just lucky. I got holes in the airplane, but nobody was hurt. And I went through all this other monkey business and was just lucky. But that train was in the right place at the right time to intercept us. Was that an accident? No way. We ran into an ambush, and that was all there was to it. Because as we went down this our route, we had haystacks on either side, and the top of the haystacks would open up, and here they exposed a bunch of guns. Well, they were waiting for us, and that's all there was to it. The question number one was, you want to tell them?
Go ahead.
No, you're on.
Okay. I forgot it by now.
Me too.
did you have specific targets?
That's right. Every one of the 178 bombardiers had a specific target. And just dropping bombs on the storage tanks didn't do any good, because you can rebuild those in a hurry. But what you need to do is bomb the most important parts of the refinery, and that would be the powerhouses and, let's say, other things that were important. Well, the Germans were smart enough to build concussion walls around those most important parts of the refinery. And the idea was, if we could see the ground, the bombardier was supposed to drop the bomb inside of those concussion walls. Well, when you can't see the ground, well, what the hell? So really, the guy that screwed up was K.K. Compton. And I talked with him when I was writing the book. I wrote a book about this, or I was a co-author of a book. And we wrote a book, and it explains the exact problems that we had, and also what was reported and what's a bunch of baloney. And when I was doing that and getting the data, I contacted now General K.K. Compton. And I contacted him, and I asked him a bunch of questions. And I said, some of these questions are going to be tough for you to answer. He says, I don't care. He says, tell me whatever you want. Ask me anything you want. And so I did, and I said, who made the wrong turn? Who was responsible for that? He said, I was. And I said, you know, that's the first time you've ever admitted it. He says, I was. He said, I made the wrong turn. Well, if you look at some of these pictures, there's a picture of Compton here, and that man in the middle is General Ent. The guy in the right is Compton. And you notice that he has something under his arm? Well, those were charts. And incidentally, those charts were made from road maps supplied by Michelin Tire Company. We were only 150 feet, and the charts that you see that you normally get are from high altitude. So they weren't any good. So we had to have charts that were down low. Anyway, he was navigating. Compton was navigating, and I talked with his navigator later, and the navigator says, I wasn't navigating, and that's all he said. And it was Compton that was navigating, so he turned at the wrong place. And when he did that, it screwed up that whole mission. But all he had to do, if you go off your heading, what do? You turn back on your heading, don't you? Well, that's what he should have done. And all that was around there were cornfields. There wasn't anybody shooting at us. We didn't get shot at until we turned on that down from the IP down, and then we got shot at. But he was the one that caused all the problem. He should have been court-martialed. Incidentally, he told me that he said, I recommended to General Ent, who was with him on the airplane, he said, I recommended to General Ent that we court-martial Killer Kane. And that was the guy that was leading my group, our group, not my group, but the group that I was in. And I said, why? I said, he didn't have anything to do with it. Well, he didn't stay up with me. I said, what if he did stay up with you and he had to make a decision whether to follow you or to stay on course? I said, what would he have done? He said, I don't know. I said, I don't know what he'd do. He'd stay on course. He wouldn't follow you. He said, but I recommended to Ent that we court-martial him. I said, you don't want me to report that in the book. And he said, yes, I do. So we put it in the book. But he turned from a, he was 27-year-old colonel. And he turned from a 27-year-old colonel to a general long before he retired. This is a Ploesti route map and also some history about the number of airplanes that took off as well as those that returned, and 54 were shot down. Well, the route that we took actually started here at Benghazi, Libya, and we flew almost north until we came to the island of Corfu. And at the island of Corfu, we made a turn. And at that time, we were at 9,000 feet. But going to the island of Corfu, why, we were somewhere around 4,000 feet, but that was all. We did see a submarine that was charging their batteries somewhere along this route. So they probably did radio to their headquarters that we were on our way. But in Corfu, I'm sure, since it was a German-occupied island, I'm sure that they had spotters there. And so they reported it. Because when we got into Ploesti, that train that we encountered could not have been exactly where it was unless they had previous information about how we were going to go there or what our speed was. And the reason that we were 9,000 feet in Corfu was that because along this Albanian coast, there are high mountains. Now, when we saw these mountains, they were covered with clouds. Now, when you have 100 and some odd airplanes, 110 airplanes behind you, the leader has a real difficult situation. And how to get 110 airplanes, let's say, over the mountains in the weather without everybody running into each other. Well, we were in what they call loose formation, which if you see air shows, you'll see that they're right next to each other and so forth. The planes are in perfect formation. Well, when you're in a mission like that and you have so many hours of flying, you can't fly like that because it's too much, it's too fatiguing. So we were spread out. So when he encountered the problem of how to get these airplanes through this weather, all we did was get up high enough so that we would not hit the mountains. And we went through almost in loose formation. And if you think about it, close your eyes sometime on the freeway and keep going and hoping that nobody changes position. And that's the way that we felt going through those clouds. And they weren't very thick, and in about a minute or a minute and a half or 2 minutes, why we broke out on the other side. But nevertheless, that is what we encountered. Then after we did that, we started to let down. And we were about 3,000 or 4,000 feet going over after Albania into Bulgaria. That was very beautiful because everything was farmland and nice and green and everything else in contrast to what we had been seeing over the desert. Why, it was just like a Sunday ride in the country. And I was just thinking about that same thing. I said, oh, isn't this gorgeous, you know, not thinking about what was going to happen. So we finally got into Bulgaria and into Romania, and nothing happened when we got there except when we hit the town of Ploesti. And then we turned, and then all hell broke loose. And that's where the train met us. And when that train met us, it started to shoot. It wasn't any fun anymore. We weren't going down a country road. But we did see a lot of hay wagons and horses, and the guys were up there waving at us and everything else. And then after we hit Ploesti, I joined up with the leader of the group, and then he had three engines running, so I had to slow down. I had to drop gear and also drop flaps in order to not overrun them. And we were only up about 500 feet or less. And we turned around and we made it back. And he decided to fly right over Turkey, which we did. And it took a long time because he had three engines running. And the problem there that you have is that you have to use all the power you got in order to climb with three engines. And he threw out everything in the airplane, everything. The bottles, the oxygen bottles, and they chopped them all out. They chopped everything out of the airplane that he could do it. And I was on his wing, and I saw this stuff coming out of the airplane, and I backed off and let this junk fall down. And then when we arrived at Cyprus was dark. It wasn't nobody, I mean, not a bit of light. And finally, wise the lead plane sent out the code of the day. And when that happened, we got a light, and the runway lit up. Well, I was flying downwind, and I was number two to land, or number three to land. And the first guy to land, of course, was a colonel. And as I was going downwind, and I hadn't turned on the base leg, all of a sudden, I saw these sparks on the from the airplane. And I thought, holy God, he's crashed. Well, that's what happened. He crashed on landing. So the problem was that we were out 14 hours, and we didn't know how much oil we had. We had a lot of gas, but we didn't know how much we could measure gas, but we can't measure oil. And these engines burn a lot of oil. And so I didn't know what we were going to do right at that moment, whether to fly around over the field and parachute out, or take a chance and try to get down here to Palestine. And that's over water. And these airplanes are not good on ditching. In fact, it's suicide to try to ditch one of them. So before I had to make the final decision, another runway lit up and we landed in Cyprus. And then the next day, I stood down on the ground and watched them take 5-gallon cans and pour it into our plane. They had to go up a ladder, and I wasn't ready for that action right at that moment. But anyway, we got down to Palestine, and the Red Cross was terrific. And they knew we were coming, and they had a hotel, and they said, we're going to clean your uniforms. Well, I had been up 14 hours and sitting in my own seat. And when I landed at Cyprus, boy, I'm telling you, those flowers grew with all the liquid that came out. But anyway, we got down to Palestine, so they said we would wash your clothes. So fine. So we let them do that, and they cleaned up. We had all fresh uniforms, and they fed us, and oh, it was great. The Red Cross did a fine job. And then the next day, there were just two of us there. And the colonel was with us. And so anyway, I revved up the engines and was pre-flighting it and so forth. And somebody in front of me said, cut the engines. So I cut the engines, and I saw the colonel come up. And they opened the door and let him come in. And he said, I want to fly back with you. I said, do you want to fly it? He says, no. He says, I'm tired. I'm going to go in the back and go to sleep. And so I said, okay. So anyway, I didn't know why they selected me to take that colonel back, see. For almost 35 or 40 years, I didn't know why. But anyway, I took him back to Benghazi. Well, when we got to Benghazi, you know, after going through all that we went through, I was on the final and just about ready to land, you know, and I couldn't see a damn thing. We don't have any windshield wipers on our airplanes. And I couldn't see out front. I couldn't see whether, you know, I was in a position with the nose up and ready to set it down. And so I opened up the side window and looked sideways and landed the airplane in Benghazi. And it wasn't a bad landing. You know, acceptable. I'm here today. This is a chart of the actual routing for the Ploesti raid. And we were to go down, to this town, and Tragovinsky is here, and then to go to Ploesti, which is over here. And the leader, who was about 60 miles ahead of us, made a turn at Tragovinsky and went down using the same route, same course that we were going to use at Ploesti, which paralleled the railroad track. As you can see the railroad track here? And see, this is they're just about the same. Instead of turning where he was supposed to, which was up here, he turned at this town. And other airplanes were calling him. I didn't hear it, but other airplanes were calling him and said, not here, not here, not here. But he didn't pay any attention. And so he got down this far, and according to him, I talked with him. I said, how many minutes was it from here to the time that you made the turn? Well, he said about 8 or 9 minutes. So if you program that and you figure up the 180 miles an hour or so ground speed, it puts him way down here near Bucharest. And according to the archives from Romania, he actually flew over an airfield where the radar stations were. And I'm sure that confused the Germans like mad, because you're not supposed to fly over the radar stations. Anyway, he made a large turn, and he went over this little town called Sagafu. And there's a man in Costa Mesa by the name of Cornel Ishalu, who was a little boy in that town and saw these airplanes overhead. And anyway, this over here, there's a bunch of reservoirs. And anyway, he went over this place and went around Ploesti, not hitting any of the refineries, and came back home. And he was a colonel then, and he ended up as a general, ending the war. This picture here shows General Doolittle presenting me with the DFC on the desert in Benghazi, Libya, along with the other guys in 1943. I think the most famous picture of World War II is showing this airplane over the burning refineries at Ploesti, Romania. And I was the pilot of that plane. And it was the interesting thing is that how it was taken. Well, these cameras that they had in some of the airplanes were mounted at the rear of the B-24s. And they had the cameras inside And there's a hole right at, or an opening right at this place in all these B-24s. And it was designed to mount a camera so that it could take pictures straight down. But they moved the camera on an angle, and they put outside a mirror. When they took a picture of the mirror, of course, the image is reversed. So many times you will see the picture like this. This was a magazine, or rather a newspaper. It wasn't this color. It has aged. But it's the paper that was published in Palestine when I was over there, and the dates on it and everything. But you'll find that the picture looks like this. And this is not the way it happened. This is only because the mirror was reflecting this image, and they were taking a picture of the mirror. This has become a real problem in many of the publications. And one of the most recent things is that the National Geographic Company has commissioned a company in Boston to do a DVD or a documentary about Ploesti for the Romanian audience, which will be shown December the 1st in 2010. And the cover was made by the people in Boston. And this is the way that the cover was proposed. And this says that it's about Ploesti and so forth, and it shows the correct way to print it. But the editor of the National Geographic in Washington objected to this, because that isn't the way that the archives send it out. They send it out like this. Well, being the pilot of that plane, I should know which way the smokestacks were. And so anyway, I got an email just this morning from the editor, or rather the owner of the company that did this documentary and also did this, that we won the war over Ploesti. In other words, they're going to publish it like this as it should be instead of the way that it came from the archives. Thank you, people.
Thank you for watching Peninsula Seniors Out and About here at the Western Museum of Flight in Torrance. I'm Betty Wheaton. I'll see you next time.